biggest station in the world, playing all of today's hits. You're listening to Instinct Radio.
Good afternoon and welcome to RCR Presents Real Discussions. I'm your host for today, Michelle Dawes-Bird, for a special edition. Those that watch my show and know that I'm typically on Sundays, every first and third Sunday from 2 to 4. But today is so special that we had to just do a special edition and pop up. Today I'm going to have a conversation with Lil Louis, the founding father of house. Lil Louis, welcome. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you. My pleasure to be here.
Thank you so much. We're so excited that people have been waiting. They're like, come on, it's 4 o'clock. Let's go. Let's get started.
All right.
So welcome to Atlanta. Welcome to Atlanta.
I'm happy to be here.
We're welcome. We're glad that you're here. We apologize for the traffic.
It's just horrible
just trying to get about. But we're glad that you were able to get here safely. Mm-hmm. I want to take it back to when you were a little kid or younger in Chicago, right?
Okay,
Born and raised in Chicago. Is that correct?
Absolutely.
All right. So tell me a little bit about that.
Well, I was born a few years ago.
Okay. Okay.
And, you know, came up in a very dynamic setting. Mm-hmm. Was born on the west side of Chicago. And mom and dad raised us in a very spiritual setting, mm-hmm. but we were ensconced in abject poverty. Mm. So there was a lot of racism around us. Mm. You know, it was a hard but a beautiful upbringing.
Mm.
And, you know, music was always surrounding, it was always in the periphery. So, you know, from the moment that I can remember, even until now, music was somehow, you know, around me and, mm-hmm. and urging me somewhere.
Mm, somewhere. Yeah. And that made it beautiful for you, even though the racism was like in your face, but you still had this music that kind of kept you going through day to day.
Yeah. I mean, to be honest with you, I think that that was the reason for the evolution of music in Chicago, mm-hmm. and I think Midwest, and I can dare say even in the world. To certain degrees, was because of things that happened, things that occurred, not because of inspirations that came from inside.
It was
things that we saw. My mother and father were talented blues musicians. Mm. And, you know, when I used to watch my father, 3 or 4 years old, direct the band, you know, they would talk about life.
Mm-hmm.
And from life, the stories would start. And to this day, that's how I write.
Awesome. Awesome. Yeah. Not to age yourself, but what were some of the music, some of the types of music that you listened to as a kid?
Howlin' Wolf.
Okay.
Muddy Waters.
Mm-hmm.
We listened to blues. Mahalia Jackson.
Yes.
My mom was absolutely in love with her. And my mom and dad were signed to Chess Records.
Yeah.
So, So we had a real rooted history in blues.
Nice.
And also, you know, some jazz.
Mm-hmm.
But I was listening to other things too. Like when I watched television, I was really fascinated by soundtracks.
Really?
Yeah. And I think when you listen to the new albums that I'm putting out, mm-hmm. you'll hear that finally. You know, eventually I had became classically trained,
mm-hmm.
On keyboards. But first and foremost, it was the television and it was the movement, you know, as per space and melody.
Nice.
That was really attracting me.
Nice. Now, as a young kid in Chicago, were you a musician at that time while you were absorbing all this music?
Well, to be honest, I had no interest in being a musician at first. Yeah, my thing was sports.
Really?
And, I was a my dream was to be a professional baseball player.
No.
Yeah, my inspiration was Billy Williams, the Chicago Cubs, and Fergie Jenkins. And,
really?
Yeah, so, you know, my mother and father had quit by that time.
Mm-hmm.
My mom had found God.
Okay.
And she decided to let blues go.
Okay.
And my father had a hard, more difficult time with it.
Mm-hmm.
But eventually, because of his devotion to his wife, he acquiesced as well. So they decided, my father particularly decided, that he was going to make us the gospel Jackson 5.
Is that right?
Yeah. And so I hated the proposition. I wanted nothing to do with that. But, you know, we used to get together and sing for church. And and so I always kind of resisted, but it kept pulling me.
Mm.
And my first real memory of singing was, I think, 5 or 6 years old. I think I was five or six. And there was this guy that was talking, his pastor was talking. He was boring me. And so I just went up and I pulled his coattail and I said, listen, I'd like to sing.
Really?
Yeah, and everyone started laughing and he was embarrassed. And I started singing This Little Light of Mine. Mm. And my mother told me that was my song. That's my destiny.
That was everybody's staple
at that
age. But
yeah,
I'm sure it was really good.
Yeah. And so from there, you know, I started playing drums. I became really interested in drums. And that was the first instrument that kind of stuck with me. Mm-hmm. And but, you know, eventually I had this conflict between sports and that.
Yeah.
And through a really bad car accident, sports lost.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, so I was almost killed in a car accident when I was a freshman.
Wow.
In school. And by that time I was playing basketball, but that kind of severed that.
Yeah, yeah.
And so music just took center stage.
Yeah, that was the pursuit. Yeah. What were some of your musical influences during this time?
To be honest with you, I would say my father and my mother were influences. I was inspired by a few people.
Okay.
One of the strangest inspirations for me was Led Zeppelin.
Really?
Yeah, my father was a Good Humor ice cream truck driver. And he used to park outside of Chicago Stadium. And so in the early 70s, you know, I was his partner. So, you know, I would go out with him and help him sell his ice cream. And a promoter at Chicago Stadium, they became, I guess, buddies. He would give him ice cream or whatever. So he said, listen, would your son like to go and see a concert? And he said, yeah, sure. So Led Zeppelin was playing.
Wow.
So the first show that I ever went to was Led Zeppelin. And he literally took me up to the front seat.
Wow.
And I just remember looking at this man with these tight pants on, gyrating as hard as he could. And the audience was just mesmerized. And I was mesmerized. And every move that he made meant something.
Right.
And I think that's the first time I realized the authority, not the power, because God has all power, but the authority that musicians and artists have. And if you understand the connection, you know, you can use that authority.
Awesome.
And so now even when I play and when I create music, I think about that.
Wow.
That's my approach.
Wow, wow. So now we're still in Chicago, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we made it through this accident. Thank goodness you're still here, right? So you've made the decision that you're going to really focus on music. Was it just becoming a musician? How did you really start to throw yourself into the music side?
Well, there was another accident that happened when I was 12 in 1974, so I will give my age away voluntarily. But my mother, because she was all about the community, she started giving these parties, and it was these crazy, insane parties where she would invite the heads of gangs to all get together, Jeff Ford and all of these guys,
right,
and Black Gangster Disciples and Vice Lords.
Yeah.
Her philosophy was the reason that they were enemies was because they weren't familiar with each other. Mm. And so, she wanted to bring them together, which I thought was crazy.
Right.
And so she did that. And so we had this party on the West Side, and it was just lit up with gangs. It was just chock full of gangs, and I was serving punch. And there was this guy named Tommy, who was the DJ, and he was actually my sister's boyfriend. And in the middle of the party, Tommy had an epileptic seizure.
Hmm.
And so, you know, I look over, and next thing he's pulling the turntables, only one turntable, over on the ground, and everything fell, and he's trembling and biting his tongue. And so I actually stuck a spoon, my punch spoon in his mouth, and literally saved his life.
Wow.
And so while he was over in the corner waiting in an ambulance, because they don't come on the West Side, my mother said, well, listen, something has happened because people started pulling their guns out, and they said they were going to shoot up the place. Mm. And she said, Louis, go play a song.
Wow.
And so I'm like, I don't know what to play.
Yeah.
And she said, I don't care, figure it out. And so I went over, and I'm looking through records, Tommy's records, and I look up at the audience, and they look at him, and you better play something good. And I saw Jungle Boogie. And I thought, you know what, this is apropos. So I put it on, and that was the very first song that I played. It was June 29th, 1974.
Wow.
And the reaction that I got from that song, that's when I knew that I couldn't run from it anymore. you know, I knew at that point that it was,
this was it.
Yeah, I was still all about sports.
Yeah, but that was it.
That was it. And so from there, I started DJing. And this gentleman named Milton Green mm-hmm. heard me playing because he was renting sound. Mm-hmm. And he told my mom that he really liked the way I programmed. Mm. And so he started taking me to these adult parties, and this other guy on the west side noticed me. So at 12 years old, all of a sudden, I'm DJing at adult
really?
Parties. Yeah.
They sneaking you in?
Yeah, I was playing the way my name Lil Louis came, because there was I was playing at this club called River's Edge.
Okay.
And there was a police riot. There was a riot, and so the officer, one of the sergeants, came in, this big racist guy, and he looked at me, and so he started cussing, like, "What the fuck is this guy doing? Mm. What? Why is he here? Like, mm-hmm. he's underage." And Milton said, "Listen, I'm his guardian, and you know, and he's fine, and yeah. he's not drinking." So the guy came over to me and leaned over and he said, "What's your name?" And I said, "Louis." Mm-hmm. He said, "Okay, Lil Louis, if I catch you drinking, I'm going to lock you up." So I said, "Okay, I don't drink." And, and from that point forward, my name was Lil Louis.
Lil Louis.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, you know, things kind of, no accidents. It all kind of leads.
It all works yeah. itself out. Yeah. So now you're DJing, right?
Right.
You're DJing these parties. You still got this thing for being an athlete
right.
on the side.
Right.
How did you feel when you're doing these parties? I mean, like, was it 50 people, 100 people in the room? What's give me a feel for?
Well, I mean, you know, I was playing some of the main clubs. There's a place called the Golden Fork, mm-hmm. another place called MGM Grand. MGM, I mean, they would have 700-800 people.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah,
and
so
how old are you when you're doing this?
12, 13
years old.
Yeah, but you know, from day one, I knew what I wanted, because I gave in, submitted to my vision.
Okay.
And I think, you know, a lot for me, mm-hmm. it doesn't start with what's happening out
right.
there. It starts with what you're feeling and what God has given you. God gives me clear visions. Mm-hmm. Like all of the songs that are quote unquote hits that I've made, they're mm-hmm. Blackout, for instance, that was a vision.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, you know, my visions are from beginning to end. And then I follow those visions, and it's pretty simple to execute. Not always easy, but pretty simple to execute. Mm. So I think that's kind of it germinated and developed from maybe a stubbornness that I saw in my dad and my mom, because
yeah.
you know, they were real pure artists. My
yes.
dad was an artist, so he didn't yield to the art.
I got you.
And yield to the pressure.
Right,
you know?
Right.
Yeah.
He went with the vision.
Yeah.
He go with the vision.
Absolutely.
So now you're playing 700 to 800 people in the room. Give me a couple of the songs that you played. Was it disco infused? Was it R&B? Was it soul or whatever?
It was the R&B, because I started before disco.
Mm-hmm.
And in 74, there really was no disco.
Okay.
But I was literally the first person in Chicago that started playing up-tempo songs.
Gotcha.
And in fact, I got fired from every club that I played up until 1979 because
really?
Of that.
Really?
Yeah. And I also got a gun put in my mouth because I wouldn't play a song that I didn't like. So I was, you know, I had gained a reputation of being stubborn to what a DJ was.
Right,
because
right.
the perception of DJ back in the early 70s was you play what you're told, you're a jukebox.
Right, and you know.
Yeah, and but I'd seen my father, and I'd seen Led Zeppelin, and I'd seen people
yeah.
that had identities.
Right.
So my philosophy was, even though you're paying me $10 for the whole night, because that's what I got when
right.
I first started DJing, $1.25 an hour. It was still, you were hiring me, so you were going to get my art. You were going to get what I felt.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I think the stubbornness paid off eventually, but it got me a few knocks
in the
beginning.
Do you remember the song you refused to play at gunpoint?
I believe it was.
Just interested to know.
Well, I was threatened twice. One time was Just Got Paid, which I hated that song.
By Johnny Kim?
Yeah, I just wouldn't play it. To me, I just didn't like that song. I didn't care how popular it was. And I think it might have been Full Tilt Boogie.
Okay.
Yeah, it was 45 caliber.
All right.
That's kind of what I remember.
The gun.
More
so
than
the song.
Yeah,
I got
but
you.
I was threatened also by Johnny Kim.
Wow.
Yeah. But it didn't matter because I wasn't
you weren't
playing.
Gonna do it.
No.
Let's fast forward a little bit. When you got your first record cut, played, distributed, and you're playing it, mm-hmm. how did you feel hearing your own music being played in the club?
Well, before I got the first record cut, I had made a bunch of songs okay. before.
All right.
I was in this group, and I'm almost ashamed to say what the name of this group was. I'll say it, because you're going to hear about it in the film. The group was called The Sounds of Love, and that's the corniest name ever, ever. And I own that, right? But I was, you know, I was 13, 14, what do you want from me,
Sounds
right?
Sounds of Love.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And there was this guy, Big Lip Willie, who played bass. Big Lip Willie was serious.
Okay.
He was a serious, serious player. And anyway, so we made some songs, and then with the disappearance and actually the death of disco, quote unquote, mm-hmm. You know, I realized that I couldn't afford to go in the studio. Secondly, that whole premise was different now.
Yeah.
And I needed to kind of do something on my own. So, when disco died, a lot of the clubs turned on dance music DJs.
Okay.
And so I started doing private parties. And to bring an audience to me on a regular basis, I started making songs. Mm-hmm. And the only way you could hear those songs were at my parties.
Okay.
So pretty soon people started saying, well, you know what? Louis is playing these strange stuff. Mm-hmm. And the only way you can hear it is to go. So it was a marketing thing. Mm-hmm. And then I realized that people were bootlegging my music
right.
and people were coming in there with cassettes. And then I saw a couple of my songs out as a record. I'm like, you know what, let me make this record instead of just singing this record. And so the first time I put a song out, it was kind of an out of body thing to actually mm-hmm. see my name. You know, okay. it was an interesting thing.
Okay.
But, you know, it was also never an end goal. Like, mm-hmm. I didn't have that. I didn't want to be an artist then.
Okay.
I actually was cool with just being a DJ right. and a promoter. But, you know, God knows his plan, and
right,
it
right.
has nothing to do with mm-hmm. your plan. You know, so, mm-hmm. I submitted.
Okay. So you're playing the record. What was the response in the room?
It was cool. It was cool. Yeah. I mean, it was just different because, mm-hmm. you know, the my approach was never conventional or traditional.
Right.
So,
okay.
you know, like for instance, I, you know, I run a lot of my instruments very hot without geeking out. I run a lot of my instruments very hot.
Mm-hmm.
And I also come from an era of vocals.
Mm-hmm.
So I, you know, if you listen to my vocals run very, very hot.
Mm-hmm.
But if you go back to Motown, if you go back to Nat King Cole, mm-hmm. you go back to Mahalia, those vocals were up there.
Mm-hmm.
It was about the story,
right,
about the song.
Right.
And so when you look or listen to the average dance song, how some of the vocals aren't really hot.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the strangeness that I was doing at first, and even now sometimes, has to catch up
mm-hmm.
to what is
yeah.
conventional mm. or traditional,
mm.
which I don't care about.
Tell me a little bit about the DJ culture then, and then we'll talk about it now.
Okay.
So you're 12, now you're getting a little older, right? Now,
yeah.
when you cut your first record, how old were you when you did that?
I think I was 21, 22,
okay.
something
okay.
when I actually cut the record.
Mm-hmm.
So by then, you know, it was a real DJ culture.
Gotcha.
But in the '70s, you were basically a radio DJ that mm-hmm. was doing a guest appearance at a club.
I gotcha.
So if you look, you know, someone like a Herb Kent from
mm-hmm.
Chicago,
mm-hmm.
I was a glorified Herb Kent.
Kent.
You know, and I was really the first DJ that refused to talk. And the reason I refused to talk was because someone made fun of me.
Really?
Of my voice, yeah. When I was young, I had a very high-pitched voice,
okay.
you know, and so I remember the first time I had to make an announcement, I was terrified, and I literally had my head, my legs, like, with the mic off for, like, 45 minutes, because I was very shy as a child.
Okay.
And then by the time I turned the mic on and tried to announce it, just squeaks came out. And so, you know, this guy that I really admired, you know, said something very negative.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I just decided, you know what, I'm not going to speak.
Right.
I don't have a good voice. And
right.
God blessed my vocals to come down a little bit. And
okay.
now I can speak.
Now you can speak.
But I think what that taught me and what that showed me the path that led me is to let the music talk. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, when I stopped talking, my expression increased.
Okay.
The musical expression increased.
Right.
And then, you know, I saw a lot of other people that stopped talking as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because at first in the 70s, everyone talked. That's just the way it was.
Okay.
You know, you played a song.
Yeah.
You have one turntable. And in between the songs, that was the Mighty Clouds of Joy or whatever it was. Or the Spinners or whatever, you know. And, you know, so we eliminated that when we got, you know, a mixer.
So now, what is your viewpoint on the DJ culture today? From what you see and gather or sense and feel from it?
It's dynamic and linear at the same time.
Mm.
I think that we don't have people, a lot of people, pushing through the force field.
Mm.
And, you know, I am blessed to be in the position that I am, that I don't have to be PC.
Right.
And so a lot of the younger DJs, and even the DJs that have come after me that are now established, I always try to push them towards their own creative voice.
Right.
But what I hear often is a linear expression, something trying to get out of a box that doesn't quite get out of the box.
Right, right.
And the box is, you know, what is popular, what is
what
you need to play in order to move to the next level.
Yeah.
I don't believe in any of that.
Yeah.
I'm going to play what I play. I'm doing an after party at Wild Pitch on Saturday, and I'm going to play what I play.
Yeah.
And when I go to Japan, I play what I play. It doesn't matter where I go, because if you want me to come, I'm going to come with my music, you know what I mean? As opposed to what is hot or popular.
Not, what's not. Yeah.
And so, you know, I'm hoping perhaps, you know, in me taking willingly the lead, that others will, you know, follow suit and push out of this box.
Yeah.
You
know, yeah. It's about supply and demand too. And you know what? Also, DJs are very powerful in the sense, and you talked about power. Because you can make the room change. You can make the temperature change in the room. You can get people to respond to you.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people don't take time to invest in that power to understand that.
Right.
There is an understanding of music. You have to understand music.
Sure.
Not to be a musician, but just understand what's going to work, what's not going to work, how to braid it, how to blend it, how to go from here to there and still be unique. A lot of people do just kind of stay in the box because it's safe.
Yeah.
And you go through the top 40 or whatever it is, but it's just, it's boring.
Right.
But then when you take that route, you're not going to the bank maybe as much. So there's so much in stepping out of the box. You definitely have to be a risk taker.
Right. Well, I think the power is waiting for you, just as the bank is waiting for you.
Gotcha.
You have to submit. I mean, you know, I have to say, you know, a lot of synergy. There's a lot of synergy between sex and music.
Yes, it is.
And the best times I've had is in moments of submission.
All right. Okay.
And so, you know, if you're trying to take the lead all of the time, it's linear.
Yeah.
And pretty soon you will either wear your partner out or bore her into tears.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm all about submission. You know, I think going back to the power thing, the reason that I'm writing, I think the best stuff that I've ever written is because I've yielded any and all vulnerabilities. All the macho stuff is gone. I'm just writing.
Mm-hmm.
And there are times when, you know, I look like an absolute fool in this album. And I'm fine with that because everyone on this planet has looked like a fool.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And so right there, people will relate to me, whether they do it openly or not. And, you know, if you look at all of going back through my history, my most powerful records, speaking of the power, are the most submissive records.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
So I do think there's something to be said for giving in,
yeah.
for yielding, for allowing the room to talk to you, for looking in that person's eyes.
Yeah.
You know, my mother said something that stayed with me. You know, she passed on about a year ago.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the things she said when she was singing is that she would always pick the enemy.
Yeah.
And by the time she was done singing, that person was her friend.
Wow.
And so, you know, my philosophy is, you know, whether you're a hater or lover, it doesn't matter to me. It doesn't matter to me. By the time I'm finished, you're going to enjoy yourself and you're going to feel something.
Yeah.
And that will to allow you to fail, I think, drives me forward and allows me to fail.
Awesome. We're honored that you're here in Atlanta for your album release on the 31st at 595. Why Atlanta? Why would you want to do that here?
Well, I have an affinity for Atlanta for a couple of reasons. Right. One, there's a real relationship between Atlanta and Chicago.
Okay.
That just
yeah,
is.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, there's a lot of synergy.
Yeah, there is.
And I think there's also a drive that is very similar. There's oppression down here. There's oppression there.
Yes.
And I think that there is a need and a will for the art to shine lights on that.
Yes.
In both places. I know quite a few people down here. And so, you know, when I was thinking about my U.S. tour, I followed my instinct because, you know, I have the ability to tour anywhere.
Yeah.
But I thought, you know, if I'm going to do Chicago, I have to do Atlanta. I just have to.
You just got to.
Yeah. You know, and so I'm very, very happy that I have. I'm not sure what to expect. But I know what people can expect from me.
Yeah.
They can expect my best work.
Yes.
And by the way, too, it's an album review, so I want to be clear because the albums, I have 6 albums coming out back to back.
Wow, okay.
And in the last close to 7 years, I've written about 1,600 songs. So what we're going to do is, as I've done, I just did a review in Chicago last Thursday, did Boston the week before. I've done a review in London, Paris, and Kiev. In Glasgow, Scotland. And so what we do is we take people on a journey, you know, my story, how I came to write these songs, some of the things that happened in my personal life. And then we play a song and let people dance their hearts out.
Awesome.
So
Album review.
Album review.
Yeah. On the 31st here at 595 North.
Yes.
7 o'clock. So for those people that did not RSVP, please RSVP on Eventbrite so you can be a part of it. I did.
All right.
I'm gonna be there. I'm gonna be present.
Yes, the tickets are free too. Yeah. So I think they have to because they're running pretty fast. Mm-hmm. They're running out pretty fast, so they have to get those free tickets at Eventbrite.
Absolutely. One thing about you in just in this conversation is I sense that you're extremely unapologetic about the things that you've done, the decisions that you made. No regrets. That's just the path that you've taken. This is the way that you need to go. What kind of suggestions or advice would you give for other people? Just follow that passion, follow that gut, because it works.
I think I'm going to go a little bit more nuanced into it.
Okay.
I do have regret.
You do.
I do. And I have such deep regret until my reflection surpasses that. Mm. And so I think when you reflect on things, mistakes that you've made, I've made so many mistakes in my life.
Okay.
You know, I'm very passionate about things. Okay. And sometimes in your passion or whatever, in your pursuit of something, you'll skip details. Mm-hmm. But I do not live in regret.
Okay.
So I think the problem with a lot of people is either they don't regret anything, so they just bowl over the world.
Okay.
Or they live in regret and they don't move. Mm-hmm. So you keep making those same mistakes. You know, so I absolutely have a ton of regrets. But I know that when I wake up in the morning, I'm doing my best.
Okay.
And I push harder than anyone that I know. And that's been a mandate since I was a little boy. Mm-hmm. You know, when I was going around with my father selling Good Humor, I was also playing basketball. And I was a straight A student. Mm. So I literally, and I started DJing at clubs. So I would literally sleep 3 or 4 hours a day.
Wow.
And I still do that.
Mm.
So, you know, I believe that this is the life that we have to live now. This is the time. My mom proved to me that no matter how vibrant you are and how beautiful you are and how special you are, you will die.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so now I have an urgency. Which I guess maybe lends itself to me seeming unapologetic, but I have an urgency. So either you are with me,
I got you,
or you have to get out of my way.
I got you.
Because it's going to happen.
I got you. Yeah. Nice and clear. Which hat do you like wearing the most?
Oh, wow.
DJing, producing, writing, being a musician. I mean, you have so many hats. Which one is your
film directing?
Ooh. Film directing. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, it's really crazy for me to say that because I had no interest in directing film at all. But someone said something to me a long time ago. Said, you know, Louis, in the studio, you're a natural director. And that stuck with me. And I was always a frustrated director anyway. Okay. You know, and that's why, you know, with a lot of my music, you know, you can kind of visualize. Mm-hmm. I'm sure you can visualize what happened in French Kiss. Mm-hmm. And the reason why I wanted to paint that visual is because I wanted you to be in a room.
Yeah.
You know, I wanted you to witness what was going on in that moment. Yeah. But now I can actually give you the colors.
Okay.
So now it's just not just the music, the audio. And you're imagining the blues or the hues.
Right.
You know the color now.
Right, right.
And so it's allowed my art to really bloom and blossom. Mm. So, you know, my mom, before she passed, she said, well, you make sure that you leave with that music because that's the gift God gave you.
Yeah.
And so with the film and with everything I'm doing, that's why I'm doing the album first, mm-hmm. the soundtracks first.
Yes.
I want people to understand that the gift is appreciated mm-hmm. and it's leading me somewhere else. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I like the camera.
You like the camera?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you find that that there's a big difference between your music here in the States versus Europe? How are you received in Europe? I'm sure, like, tremendously well, I'm sure.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's no secret that most, you know, dance music artists are appreciated a lot more mm-hmm. over there, save for perhaps EDM, which is just, you know, it is what it is. And I have an appreciation for whoever does something legal.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not here to knock EDM. I will never play it, ever. But I'm not here to knock it. But I think that what we have to do is recognize the size of our picture.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for instance, these album reviews, you know, everyone that comes, the thing I hear over and over again is, I can't believe how big the production is.
Yes.
And, you know, I hired full orchestras
really?
To do some of the songs. So, I mean, literal full orchestration. One of my songs was over 140 tracks. And it's like viola, cello, horns, everything you can imagine is in this.
And nobody does violas.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
I'm a violinist. Nobody does
violas.
There it
is. So you understand.
I understand.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But for me, it goes back to when I was a child and I was listening to Rodgers and Hammerstein.
Yes.
And I was listening to this production. And if you take the music out of it, it's a black and white movie.
Yes, it is.
You know what I mean? So, I, you know, for these albums, my philosophy is, you know what? You're going to get the raw. You're going to get the Chicago raw for me.
Yeah.
Is that some minimum nasty, just nasty house records. But you're also going to get cinema.
Mm.
You're going to get Mozart. You're going to get Debussy, you know,
wow.
Because I studied their movement
yes,
as well.
Yes.
And the musicians that I work with are seriously and classically trained. A couple of guys down here. And so, you know, we're going to get everything.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to give everything. So.
Okay. Well, God bless you, because you're not going to play EDM.
Sorry. No,
I'm not
EDM. Guaranteed.
But I got to talk about it, though, because
Sure. Today
it's different slices of music. Right.
Right.
I grew up with hip-hop, right?
Okay.
Right, so hip-hop was hip-hop. Now it's rap. Now it's trap. Now it's the...
Right.
So now we had dance music. Now it's EDM. Dance music, house, EDM... Any viewpoint on that? What is splitting the diverse, having such a diverse sound?
Well, you know, speaking of film, I have a film coming out. It's called The House That Chicago Built.
Mm-hmm.
And after I release the 6 albums, then I'm coming out with the film.
Okay.
One of the things that I'm pushing is that there's so much separation until it makes the picture smaller.
Gotcha.
You know, I have 185 DJs in my film.
Mm-hmm.
Literally everyone you can imagine. 185 DJs. I have the last interview from Frankie Knuckles right before he died.
Ooh.
And he and I talked for about 6 hours because he was my friend.
Yes.
And there's a lot of stuff that people don't realize about house music because mm-hmm. it's Wikipedia and,
yeah.
you know, younger people who are involved in house are trying to talk
yes.
with authority.
Yes.
But we're going to straighten all of it out when
Please.
The film comes out.
Thank you.
And one of the things for me is to stop defining the box so small.
Okay.
You know, deep house. What does that actually mean?
Mm.
French Kiss, was it a pop record?
Mm.
what is a pop record?
Mm.
You know, because, yeah, we sold about 7 million copies of that song.
Yes.
But was it pop or was it underground? Mm. And does pop mean commercial or does pop just stand for popular?
Yeah.
It was a popular song.
Right, right.
But I don't do pop.
Yeah.
And so I think it's important for DJs to think beyond that. Get yes. beyond that. Like, yes. what does someone in Zimbabwe want to hear?
Ooh.
What is that story? And that story is very relative to your story.
Yes.
You know what I mean? I know there are women in Asia, women all over the place, in Thailand, women in South, in Brazil.
Mm-hmm.
They all have the same need for love
there
and for
go.
Story.
There you go.
So for me, if you tell the story, tempo is irrelevant.
There you go.
You know?
Man.
So I think that's what's thwarting it and also splintering it off.
Mm.
You know, you have a lot of writers who have no idea what it is, but they call it something, and I don't yield to that. Dance music is anything you can dance to. That's
period.
What it is.
Period.
Absolutely.
Period. My goodness gracious. This is just too much. It's just too much. I'm going to take a break.
Okay.
Can I take a break?
Absolutely.
I'm going to take a break. We're going to take a break. And when we come back, because I've been selfish. I've been hoarding you all to myself.
No worries.
For those that want to call in when we come back from the break, I'm going to give you the number so you can call in. But this is our conversation with the founding father of house, Lil Louis.
Right.
We'll be back in a few. Thanks.
The biggest station in the world, playing all of today's hit. We're listening to Instinct Radio.
Get lonely in different places.
Excuse me? Excuse me? Charles? My name is on the list.
What list?
The DJ's list.
Miss Thing, there is no guest list tonight.
Oh. Oh.
Lonely people, lonely. Lonely people, lonely. Lonely people, lonely.
Come on.
Come on.
biggest station in the world, playing all of today's hits. We're listening to Instinct Radio.
And we are back. This is part two with a conversation with the founding father of House, Lil Louis. We just jumped in the conversation before, so let me go over a little bit of housekeeping notes. For those that are new listening to the show, Real Chicks Rock is all about the empowerment of women, and we do it through various different vehicles. We do it through our apparel line, the t-shirt line. Thanks for everybody that's been rocking the brand. I got my engineer wearing hers today. We do it through community service. We do it through the arts, and we do it through mentoring and public speaking. Today is the arts platform. Again, this is a special edition with my guest, Lil Louis, founding father of the house. And so for those of you that want to call in, he is open to having a conversation, a brief one, real brief, like, you know, and be careful with the questions. So if you guys want to call in, the number is 478-569-6474. That's 478-569-6474. So we talked about a lot of things in the first part, mm-hmm. and I think it was very insightful. Thank you so much for being transparent,
pleasure,
and informative, and sharing. And I know there's a lot of people that are listening, taking notes, because they might have felt trapped. They were probably operating in that box. Mm-hmm. And so I think by you speaking words of wisdom and encouragement and just what worked for you, mm-hmm. they're going to step out of that box now. So hopefully we'll see and feel a shift in the music.
I love that.
Right? Right?
Absolutely.
So what does, I'm a house head, even though I said, yeah, I was born and raised in the Bronx and I grew up with house music. I mean, with hip hop. I remember when I was in high school, really getting into college, my block was so heavy saturated with hip hop that mm-hmm. I could not say I was a house head.
Right.
It was me and another guy. We would sneak out literally when I came home from college and go to Paradise Garage or go to Zanzibar. Mm-hmm. Just, I really, and guys on the corner was like, where are you going? I was like, I'm not going anywhere, but right. I'd have a bag for a change of clothes. And so from early on, I've loved the feeling of house and what it does. And everything you said today was spot on, mm-hmm. because it is, I thought it was me. I thought I was bugging out. I thought it was crazy, because it is sexual.
Right.
It is very sexual, and it's undescribable. You can't tell a non-house head how it makes you feel.
Right.
I mean, I've seen people, and the pictures don't lie, when the music hits, they immediately go in this zone, this space, mm-hmm. that it's between them, the music, the lyrics, the DJ, mm-hmm. the floor. Mm-hmm. Nobody else matters.
That's right.
The genre, I love it so much, is because I don't necessarily need you to embody me.
That's right.
I'm good with myself, mm-hmm. and I'm gone.
Mm-hmm.
And I trust the person that's pressing play, touching that vinyl, doing that magic for us to have this rapport,
right.
for however long we can go.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
What I'm finding, though, is that, to your point, people don't know how to really orchestrate that.
Right.
Then you lose my trust.
That's right.
Because at the end of the day, I'm a consumer, right?
Mm-hmm.
I work hard. I get this money. I carve out time to come spend time to get it in with you.
That's
You're
right.
doing your thing, and I'm here on the floor. We have never met.
That's right.
You don't even know me.
That's right.
I paid to get in here. I expect something. Real talk.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I feel.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So when I come in there and I can't trust you
mm-hmm.
to take me where I need to go, I'm going to grab my keys. I'm going to quietly leave and say, well,
right.
the magic didn't happen.
Right.
It's something about house music, at least for me. And I think other people will agree too. It's something that it's like, it's epic. Like
right.
when it happens and you leave that situation, you're like, my God, I'm so glad I went.
Right.
It was something about it that just washed over me. So do you feel the same way when you like, for music for you, especially for house? I mean, because
yeah.
that's what we get when you play.
Yeah, I think for me, house music represents a lot of things.
Yes.
But technically, I think a lot of DJs believe, and artists, that music is according to measures.
Okay.
You know, going from 1 to 32 or 33 to 49.
Okay.
For me, house music is a circle of measures.
Okay.
So instead of me trying to get to a destination, my philosophy is to make music melody create space so that it takes you right back to Yes. The one.
Yes.
And so by creating a circle of measures,
yeah,
it also lathers you up.
Oh, boy.
It allows you this space where you can let go and you can give in and you can submit. So once we have total submission, it's a, there's a connection. There's no longer a DJ and dancers. There's a oneness.
It's us.
It's us. And so I think for me, more important than where I'm trying to get to,
yes,
is actually creating a movement, a circular movement, so that we can keep coming back to the same love,
yes,
the same space. And every time you come back to that space, it makes you happier.
Yeah, yeah, awesome.
And, yeah.
Are you, do you have anybody that you mentor? You are there people under your wing that you're helping to share this legacy or just embody with? Because,
well, to be honest with you, one of the most beautiful things about doing the film is that I do know some of the people that I mentored directly.
Okay, great.
And there's a lot about house music that people don't realize. For instance, Ron Hardy, I mentored him. And a lot of people talk about Ron Hardy,
yes,
but very few people know Ron Hardy. Man. Ron was a tourist like me.
Okay.
And so I met Ron in the 70s, and Ron used to come to my parties, and we had a lot of conversations.
Okay.
But we talked about bigger things.
Right.
Pierre is someone, DJ Pierre is someone else that I can claim that I've mentored, and he would absolutely attest to that. But the mentorship was based on one thing I tell people all the time. I'm a mentor because I made the mistake first.
Okay.
Not because I'm better than you.
Gotcha.
You know, and
yeah,
so through that experience and through that submission, I can say safely that there are not that many DJs who are involved in house that probably won't tell you they haven't been influenced or mentored by me in some way.
Yeah.
And whenever I see someone or meet someone, my proclivity is to help move it forward,
yes,
whatever it is, especially art-wise, because I saw my father, I saw the frustration in his eyes right before he died.
Really?
Yeah, there was a moment right before he died, you know, when you know that it's hospice and it's approaching that. And he had me come into the room. This was about a week and a half before he died. And he was telling me things that he had never told anyone. And then I brought his guitar to him and I put it in the bed. And I said, you know, you've had an amazing time of it. You are an artist still.
Mm-hmm.
You're still an artist.
Mm-hmm.
And he hit the guitar and his hand had locked up. And he said, I can't play this damn thing. I can't play it. And that was a real pivotal moment for me.
Yeah.
That was a real moment. I realized that there has to be an urgency in your art. And, and you have to have someone that's pushing you and urging you forward.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I've always been that person.
Gotcha.
You know, and so now whatever, whoever I meet, you know, you're going to get that from me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because I could do what a lot of people do and stay selfish with it. But I'm not afraid of sharing what I have because you can't do it like I do it anyway.
Okay, okay.
So I'll give you everything, all the knowledge I have, you know, and then you're going to play the way you play, and I'm going to play the way I play. There's a story between Ron and me that I am going to share in the film where, you know, he basically thought that, well, now, you know, I'm the man. And so, you know, we had a moment. And it was a really beautiful moment. And people in Chicago know what happened during that moment. But afterwards, I told him, because he was a little upset, and I said, listen, man, you know, we could have the same records, same exact records. And at the end of the day, you can't be me.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, what?
Mm-hmm.
And I said, and I can't be you.
There you go.
And that's the beauty of it.
Right.
You know, the way you play is the way you play. The way I play is the way I play. And that's the beauty of art.
Right.
You know, Stevie will never be Donnie, ever. Donnie will never be, you know, Nat.
Yeah.
You know, and what we need to try to get back to now, and this is a global mentorship that I'm trying to give at least advice, get back to who you are. Forget who I am.
Right, right.
Figure out who you are, why it is that you're doing this, and open up to the story. Because I don't think a lot of people are open to the real story anymore.
Yeah.
You know, they're just trying to connect to say what you think, what they think you want to hear.
Right.
You know, even going back to you, I think what's important for the house head is for the house heads to open up again.
Okay.
Because there is a slight disconnection because people know or they feel they know a lot more about where you should take them.
Ah.
And so back in the day, it wasn't about that. It was really about, I walk into a club,
yes,
I'm open, I'm free, yes, I'm expressive.
Yes, yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
And I think if we get back to that collectively, where, yes, the artist is open and expressive to who you are and what, mm-hmm, you feel, and the house head is expressive and open to the journey that I want to take you on, mm-hmm, that's where the magic,
yeah,
is.
Yeah, that's where it happened. Yeah. Yeah. I think as we get become connoisseurs, mm-hmm, we start to have our favorites,
mm-hmm,
and then we close up.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if so-and-so's not playing, I'm not going.
Mm-hmm.
If so,
mm-hmm,
you know, I've heard one person say, I don't even go support female DJs.
Right.
It's got to be amazing.
Crazy.
It's just nuts. And
right.
I feel like it's that kind of vibration that slowly kills off the genre.
No question.
You know, and we don't want that. I
right.
mean, it's too beautiful.
Yeah.
Like, come
yeah.
on. Like, don't you want your kids to know? Don't you want to see it pass on? Like, and so I ask people, you know, when they're in that seat, like, what can we constantly do collectively to keep it growing and blooming? And because it's just, I mean, I'm going to get mine, but I want everybody to get that experience.
Right.
I just don't want it to be me in the room by myself, me and the DJ and a couple of people. I think the sometimes the best times is when it is a couple of hundred or 50 solid or 30. That's all about being open,
yeah,
ready to go on that journey musically.
Right.
So, I just want to just always want people, you know, those that are listening, just be open to it. Like,
yeah,
don't play the favorites. Just be open. Give everybody an opportunity and be ready to go on a ride.
Yeah. Expectations, I think, sometimes makes the experience small.
Yes.
You know,
yeah,
if I knew what to expect every time I made love to my girlfriend,
mm-hmm,
you know, put your leg here, you know, do it pretty soon. It's like, all right, well, I'm going to put my leg here, you know, but when I walk in open and I have no idea what to expect, and,
yes,
and it just happens, you know, from a spontaneous perspective, from an open perspective,
yeah,
the love is beautiful. That's love making.
Mm.
And if I'm going to play, if I'm going to write, love making is a part of that.
Awesome. Awesome. So the album review on Thursday, people really won't know what to expect.
Absolutely.
Really? They won't know what to expect.
Absolutely.
They just need to come incredibly open,
yeah,
to your story.
Right.
It's your story.
Yeah. And you know, it's part my story.
Okay.
But it is actually our story.
Okay.
You know, because whenever I write, even if I write something from my perspective, it's connected to something. So there's no such thing as my story.
Okay.
It really is a shared experience that is maybe from my POV.
Mm-hmm.
And then even from that, I try as a director and an artist to keep that from being biased.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause I think that so many times when you're creative, when I hear creativity, I'm like, you know what? That's not actually what you're feeling.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you're saying to be popular.
Mm-hmm.
That's not actually what you're going through.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I was on a plane today, coming here, and this nosy young lady was peering over and she saw the lyrics that I was writing about. And before she got off the plane, she said, you know, I'm a psychologist. And what I saw, I'm sorry to tell you, is incredible and it's beautiful, and
wow,
people should talk about that. So here's my card. I can show you the card.
Wow.
Here's my card, and I really want to come,
wow,
to this event. And she just saw like the first four or five lines, but it's a very vulnerable song, and
mm,
it's something that is quote unquote taboo. But for me, taboo means what? What does that actually mean? It was taboo to be black.
Mm.
You know, not too long ago.
Come on.
There's no taboo.
Right.
For me. You know, if God is connected to it, it's okay to express.
It's all right. It's all right. It's all right. Awesome. Awesome stuff. You have a tremendous body of work.
Thank you.
You do. And I said to you on the break, we are honored to be able to have these conversations where we can give you your flowers now.
Mm-hmm.
I want to know, what are we going to do with all of this body of work? How, where do you ideally want to see it end up? In a library? How do we preserve this music? How do we keep it going on and on and on and on?
You know what's really incredible? For you to say the, give you the flowers now. I had a conversation with Frankie,
mm-hmm,
and I'm getting a little emotional now because, you know, there's so many people that talk about, oh, I love Frankie and I love Ronnie, yeah, and all of these things. And you know, and the fact remains, the last 5 or 6 years of Frankie's life, mm-hmm, there was a lot of negative, a lot of negative.
Okay.
And so he and I used to talk because, you know, he could open up to me. And right, whenever Frankie was in any kind of down, I always talked to him.
Okay.
And that's another reason why, you know, you'll see in the Chicago history, I was the only person to bring me, Frankie, and Ronnie. We played together one time, and it was at my party.
Mm-hmm.
And so Ron was the same way. When Ron lost the music box, I brought him in and had him play the Bismarck.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing that made me really sad and it made me angry was that people gave him the flowers after he died. Yeah. All of a sudden, they're big fans, and I love Frankie, and I'm his right friend. And I'm like, no, you weren't. You were talking about all of these negative things. Mm. And so during our last conversation, Frankie talked about those things.
Yeah, wow.
And he talked about how it affected him. So when this film comes out, people don't realize, oh, I'm bringing the truth. So whatever people are trying to say now and whatever credit they're trying to take, they have to remember something. I was there at the very beginning, and they weren't.
Wow.
And so as per flowers, I think it would be an incredible thing for us to celebrate what God has given me and what God has given the househeads.
Yes.
Because this music that I do is not for me.
No.
And so, you know, to have hatred or jealousy or envy,
mm-hmm,
it's literally a waste of time.
Mm-hmm.
We should celebrate it now. That's why I came to Atlanta.
Yes.
I literally want to celebrate with people here, you know, something that I was able to accomplish, you know, in spite of losing my mother and
right,
father.
Right, right.
You know?
Right. Okay. So Thursday, August 31st at 595 North Event Center, right? Doors open at 7. I need you to go to Eventbrite and RSVP and come on and stop playing, because it's going to be awesome on Thursday,
yeah,
right? Because
yeah,
it's going to be you, the music, kind of like the soundtrack of your life, what you want to share a little bit with us.
Yeah, you can imagine that this will be the most intense party that you've ever gone to, had a child with MTV Unplugged. That's what it is.
Awesome.
Yeah. So, you know, in between the songs, you know, there'll be a lot of dancing during the songs. But during the song, in between, you'll hear me talking about my life and talking about the journey and understand, you know, how these songs came about. Because house music is not just a feeling. It's a lot more than that.
A lot more than that. And then you're going to give us some more on Saturday at Wild Pitch, right?
Yeah, I'm doing something that I'm only going to do a couple of more times during my DJ career, because, you know, I've been playing DJing 43 years now, since 74. I'm doing an all-night set. And the last all-night set that I did was at Rex Club. I played for 9 hours, and people are still talking about that in Paris.
Oh, my gosh.
So from open to close.
From 10 to 3 at Wild Pitch.
Yeah.
255 Trinity.
That's it.
On Saturday.
You're going to get a story.
Oh, my gosh.
A real story of the history.
How can people find you on social media? How can they keep up with you?
Can they? Yeah, I mean, I have a fan page. To be honest, I'm not really one who's on social media a lot. But Lil Louis official fan page.
Okay.
Yeah, I wrote all those songs because I'm just in the lab, you know. You know, my team, they sometimes they have to slide me food because I'm just focused on the music, you know. And yeah, the urgency is there for me.
Okay, wow. So you're just going to keep on going and keep on going and keep on
going.
Until it's all out.
Until it's time to go.
It's all out. It's all done.
Yeah.
Well, listen, you know what? I want to wish you nothing but continued success.
Thank you so much.
And everything that you do and all the hats that you wear, whatever gives you joy, whatever gives you happiness, I just want you to continue to do that. We want you to connect with us however you see fit.
Okay.
I appreciate the fact that you did what you did the way that you did it.
Okay.
And you gave me the opportunity to talk to a legend today.
All right.
So for that, I'm honored and I'm humbled and I'm thankful.
My pleasure.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, the founding father of House Lil Louis. For you guys, if you've missed any of this, don't worry. We're going to replay it, but not today. Not today. You should have been live to get it. But listen, follow me on YouTube, Real Chicks Rock channel. We did Facebook Live, so chase it down and get excerpts of this. You do not want to miss the founding father of house, Lil Louis, in Atlanta for the next couple of days. You need to be at 595 North Avenue at the Event Center. Doors open at 7. Go to Eventbrite, RSVP. It's free. You're going to get your life for free. Come on. Don't miss that. And then if you can't, because work and family and children, we understand, you have responsibilities, Saturday at Wild Pitch from 10 to 3, an all-night set. You don't want to miss that. You don't want to miss that. We want to thank Wild Pitch for allowing the founding father, Lil Louis, to be here with me today. Thank you so much. Until next time, everyone, continue to rock on.
See you Thursday.
All right.
Station in the world playing all of today's hits. We're listening to Instinct Radio.